Hey everyone, and welcome to this Wednesday's fan favorite video voted by you. And today we're going to look at how to find the domain of composite functions, right? So there's only a three-step simple process to find the domain for composite functions. So let's kick off. So before we go into finding the domain for composite functions, what is domain? It's the set of all possible x values a function can take. And then what is range? This obviously is going to be the set of all possible y values. So for this tutorial, I'm going to assume you know how to find the domain and range for functions, specifically domain, more importantly. Right. So if you're unsure how to do that, make sure to comment below that if you want a tutorial on how to find the domain. Right. Because in order to find the domain of composite functions, you need to know how to find domain for functions quickly. And finding domain is pretty easy. Range is a bit more difficult, which is why we're not covering the range for composite functions today. That deserves its own full video. All right, so composite functions. What are composite functions? So the notation is f open circle g of brackets x equals f brackets g of x. So composite function means we're going to take one function and sub it into the other function. So instead of x, we're going to replace with the actual function. And we can go the other direction, g circle f of x, where we sub f of x into g. So I'm going to show you now a three-step simple process to find the domain for composite functions. So step one, find the domain of f and g. So again, comment below if you need a tutorial on how to find domain, because I'm going to assume you know how to find domain fairly quickly, which you need to in order to do these questions. Otherwise, it'll take forever. So step two. So depending on which direction we're going, say we're going to sub g into f, well, that what that means is we're going to have to sub g of x into the domain of f of x and solve. Because when we write the domain, it's going to be some sort of inequality equation or whatnot. So we're going to sub g of x into it and create an equation we need to solve. And then we do the same thing for g circle f. We sub g, f of x into the domain of g of x. And then lastly, step three. So for f circle g, the domain is going to be the intersection of what we found here in step two and the actual domain of g of x. And then the other way, g circle f, the domain will be the intersection of what we found here in step two and the domain of f of x. So now let's go over two examples of how to apply this. So let's look. F of x equals 5 on x minus 1. G of x equals 4 on 3x minus 2. So step one in either case is find the domain for each of these functions. So step one. So the domain. Now there's different ways we can write the domain. We can use interval notation, we can write in words. I'm just going to write this one in words for now. So we can see here that x can't equal one. That's the only restriction we have. So we'd write all real x and then x can't equal one. So this is for f. Then for g, same thing, except x can't equal 2/3. So all real x, x can't equal 2/3. So it's step two. Now we're gonna do f circle g first. So what that means is we're gonna sub g of x into the domain of d, specifically the restriction. So now instead of x can't equal one, it's gonna be 4 over 3x minus 2 can't equal 1. So we solve this and find a new restriction. So if we solve this, we would take it over, bring the 2 over, and we get at x can't equal 2. So that's a new restriction for the composite. So step 3 then, the domain is going to be the intersection of this condition and the current one in for g. So if we draw that, so if we look here, so we got 2 and we have 2/3. So we have open circles here, open circles here. So x can't equal 2/3, x can't equal 2, which means everything else is acceptable. So basically we can try to write this in words or interval notation. So in words, we would write all real x, x can't equal 2, 2/3. If you want to write it in interval notation, we can write x less than 2/3, 2/3 less than x less than 2, or x greater than 2. And we can even use bracket notation if you've learned that. So this says that x is between negative infinity 2/3 union between 2/3 and 2 union 2 to infinity. So these are just three different ways I can write the domain for the composite of F circle G. So let's look at the other way for practice. So let's do G circle F. So this time we're going to go the opposite. We're going to sub F of X now into here. So now we have 5 on X minus 1 can't equal 2/3. So we have to solve this non-equation to find what X can't equal. So I'm just going to cross multiply to get rid of the fraction. So the 3 comes up here, that's 15. Can't equal, I'm going to times the 2 with that, we get 2x minus 2. Take the 2 over, and x can't equal 17 on 2. So the domain, step 3, will be the intersection of can't equal 1, can't equal 17 on 2. So 1's down here, got an open circle, 17 on 2 is what, 8.5, so it'd be all the way over here, open circle. So then everything else is fair play. So again, how do we write that? Well, we'll do the same, three different ways, just in case you want to know how to write it for each case. So we can write all real x, x can't equal 1, 17 on 2, in interval form, x less than 1, x is between 1 and 17 on 2, or x is greater than 17 on 2. Or in the bracket form, negative infinity to 1 union 1 to 17 on 2 union 17 on 2 to infinity. Right. So then again, three different ways to write the domain. So here I just showed you two examples of how to find the domain in either direction. Right, if you want to find it for G circle F or F circle G. So the good thing about this method is that it will tell you if the composite exists or not. So if you cannot solve this equation, so if this resulted in no solution, that means the composite does not exist. So again, just repeat that. If this was a no solution, like you couldn't even find a value for x here, composite would not exist. Also, it helps you find if you had unknowns and how to find the composite for those unknown values. All right, so this process gives you an algebraic way to find the domain for composite functions. And that's it for this tutorial on how to find the domain. So if you liked it, make sure to give it a thumbs up and comment below. And don't forget to actually comment if you wanted a tutorial on domain, like in general and range. All right, so range of composite functions, unfortunately, is not this easy. There's no real nice trick like this. That's why I made this tutorial, because there's three simple steps to find the domain for composite functions. So then make sure to tune in tomorrow for a special trick for solving trigonometry identities using T-formula, and just subscribe because lots of awesome videos pretty much every day.